Hello, in this lecture, we are going to discuss another important subject of inferential statistics, hypothesis testing. We are going to use hypothesizing about the population mean to illustrate how we should conduct hypothesis testing. We can actually conduct hypothesizing on many population parameters, such as the population mean, the population standard deviation, the population size, the population proportion, so on and so forth. But here, the population mean is one of the most commonly tested parameter of the population, and that's why we use that as an intro point to discuss this general techniques. The general definition of hypothesizing, it sounds like a little confusing. It is defined as use a sample statistics to determine the probability that a given hypothesis about a population parameter is true, and then use that probability to determine whether to reject the hypothesis or not. In the context of hypothesizing about a population mean, it can be defined as use a sample mean to determine the probability that a given hypothesis about the population mean is true, then use that probability to determine whether to reject the hypothesis or not. So it sounds very kind of confusing and a little tongue twister. But basically, you know that the logic of hypothesizing is to compare two things and to look for their differences. And let's say we compare a default condition, default position of a population and a sample condition. And that default condition may be the population mean, maybe the population standard deviation. And a sample is that we go out there to collect the sample, to calculate the sample mean, so that we can compare the default position of the population mean and the sample mean to see the difference between the two. For example, if the default position of if the default position is somebody's health, okay, let's say that I'm not sick. Like the default position of somebody's health is that I'm not sick. And then we go to collect this person's behavior and to see his condition in different circumstances to see that whether the evidence that we observed from a sample it conform to the statement that I am not sick, you know, he is not sick or she is not sick. So there's a default position, so-called no condition, no hypothesis about this person is that he is not sick. So this is about the default position, default condition. Then we got to collect a sample of this person's activities, his condition in various circumstances, and to compare those the evidence that we collected with this statement that he is not sick, to see whether the two things are different from each other or not. Okay, if they are not very different, and we said, you know, from the sample, we don't think that this statement that he's not sick is not true. He appears to be pretty normal, so he's not sick. So if the sample suggests that you know he is pretty normal and there's no significant difference between the evidence we collected and the default condition that he is not sick. Yeah, so we just cannot reject that default condition that he is not sick. But if we find from the sample this condition is actually not very, it's very different from the statement that he's not sick, then we say, you know, the evidence show that he is really, really not that healthy. So we have to reject this default statement that he is not sick. So it's this basically logic of hypothesizing. We compare this default position, default condition of a population, then we with a sample we'll collect it, and if the sample is very different from the default position of the population, we say, it's very different. We have to reject that null hypothesis. On the other hand, if the sample we collect is not very different from what is suggested in the default position, in the default condition, we would have no reason to reject that default position, default condition. So we say we have to fail to reject the null hypothesis. So the logic of hypothesizing is simple as that. But how do we describe the difference between the default position and the sample position and sample condition? We said that if the sample is very different from the default position, we have to reject the null hypothesis. But if the sample is not very different from the default condition, we cannot reject the null hypothesis. Now, how do we measure the difference? How different is different? So that is the key. So normally we use probability. We use probability to describe the difference between the default conditions and the sample condition. So that brings us to the next slide. Let me use this example to illustrate how do we use the probability to describe the difference between the default position or the null hypothesis and the sample. Okay, let's say that I send a number of students. I airdrop some students to North Africa. So in North Africa, we know there's a big desert, a Sahara Desert there. So I intend to airdrop those students in this somewhere in the desert. So I ask students to inform me, call me, and tell me after they are dropped in North Africa, what they have saw, what they have seen, and from what they see, I can evaluate whether they are actually being dropped to the desert or not. So this, to me, they should report to me what they see that suggests that they are in a desert, because I intend to drop them in North Africa. I intend to drop them in the desert. So the null hypothesis, the default position, the default condition is that they should be in the desert. So for them, they should be reporting what they see. Eventually they conclude that I am in a desert. So I'm in a desert is a in the default position for them, for those students that airdrop to Africa. So this is the null hypothesis, the default condition. So then we have to look at what they actually report to me and evaluate whether they are truly in the desert. So what they report to me basically is kind of evidence, a sample that I collect. Okay, now first student who called me, tell me that I saw a scorpion. I saw a scorpion. Now I think about, okay, saw a scorpion. And now I check all the people who have been to a desert in North Africa. Among them, I find out that 90% of people have seen a scorpion. I said, as we said before, that I need to compare two things. One is the default position, another is the sample. The default position here is that I'm in a desert, and the sample is that this person who are in somewhere in Africa saw a scorpion. So I have to compare these two things to see whether they are different or not. Now, scorpion, you see, you saw a scorpion, the person see a scorpion, and also how different this person so scorpion, how different this evidence is from the desert. That difference can be described by the probability. Now, from all the people who have been to North African desert, 90% have seen a scorpion. So that means that if you have been to a desert, you have a very, very good chance to see a scorpion. So the difference between the evidence and this default position is not very large, because it's, you have quite likely that somebody in the desert see a scorpion. So between this evidence that people have seen, somebody have seen a scorpion, and this statement that I'm in a desert, you don't really see a significant difference. You see that because 90% people who have been in the desert can see a scorpion. So this higher probability illustrate that between this sample and this default position, they are very similar. They're very similar. So those people who've been in the desert, 90% can see a scorpion. Therefore, when this person report to me that he saw a scorpion, I would say, between this evidence and that no, the default position, there's no significant difference. So I really cannot say that this person is not in a desert. So based on this, I said I cannot reject that no hypothesis. So you are in the desert. Okay. You are in the desert. Now, next student who called me saying that I saw a lizard. Now, again, this lizard is a sample. I need to compare this sample with the default position that I am in the desert to see how these two things differ from each other. And I look up all the records and see that every for all the people who have been to an African desert, 50% have seen a lizard. 50% is still a very high probability, and so we really do not that we really cannot say that between this evidence that somebody have seen a lizard and this default position that in a desert, you can't really not say that this between the two things there's a significant difference, because this probability is still very high for people who have been to in a desert seen a lizard. So we have no reason to reject that null hypothesis. So we say, okay, you are in the desert. A next person reported that I have seen a snake. Again, for the similar reason, I compare this sample that this person have seen a snake, compare this sample with this null hypothesis that I am in the desert. Is that very, are the two things very different? And I check my record, I've seen that of all the people who have been to in the desert in North Africa, 20%, 25% have seen a snake. And 25% is still a very large probability. And that large probability suggests that between the null hypothesis and this sample, that this person have seen a snake, it is not a significant difference. And for all the people who have been to the desert, have been to the desert, 25% have seen a snake. So this person have seen a snake, that suggests that with this high, relatively high probability, we really cannot say that between the evidence and that statement that I'm in the desert, we really cannot say that between the two things, there's a lot of differences. Therefore, we cannot reject the null hypothesis. So now you see the trend, right? This when the probability become smaller, the difference between the null hypothesis and the evidence begin to show larger differences. But as long as this probability is high enough, we can really say that we really cannot say that the difference between this evidence and this default position is different enough. As therefore, we cannot reject the null hypothesis. And the next person report that I have seen a hyena. I've seen a hyena. Hyena is a kind of animal that lives in kind of a, kind of a, in a savanna area. Savanna place is an area, it kind of place in Africa where you have high grass, you have spotted trees that can very easy for many kind of a grazing animal to live. Wildebeest, the many deers, gazelles, and also zebras. And those meat-eating animals, carnivores, would prey on those grass-eating animals. And it is this kind of condition that, in this kind of condition, hyenas, lions, and leopard, and some many other predator animals survive because they eat those grass-eating animals. So when somebody sees hyenas, and I have to look at whether the sample that somebody sees hyenas, and this no condition, the no hypothesis that I'm in a desert, whether the two things are significantly different from each other. So I have to look at my record. I look at my record, seeing that of all the people who have been to an African desert, only 5% have seen a hyena. So this low probability, the low chance in a desert to see a hyena, in that make me feel that between these two things, the no hypothesis and this evidence that somebody see a hyena, between these two things show significant difference. Between because if you have been to in a desert, only 5% people have seen a hyena. That really suggests that between these two things, between the no hypothesis that I'm in a desert and this evidence that I have seen a hyena, between these two things, there's a significant difference already, because only 5% people have seen a hyena who have been to desert. Okay. So that made me begin to think, this person may not be in the desert. May not be in the desert. So that there's a low probability of somebody who had been in the desert seeing hyena, low probability make me feel that this person may not be in the desert. That may cause me to think about rejecting the null hypothesis that he is in the desert. So let's go back to the statement that we made early on, the difference between the two things that in comparison, one is the null hypothesis, another is a sample or the evidence. Between the two things, we use the probability to illustrate the difference. If the probability of seeing those kind of evidence is high under the no condition, we have no reason to suspect that no hypothesis is not true. But if the probability of under those no conditions that this kind of evidence appear to be very low, such as 5% or 1%, that makes us feel that the difference between the no hypothesis and this evidence is too large. So we cannot ignore this large difference. We may just go ahead to reject the null hypothesis that he is a desert. Make sense? So basically, the logic of hypothesizing is compare two things. One is to compare, one is look at the default position of a population of general statement. Another is the sample, the evidence. If the sample appear to be very different from the default position, very different from the null hypothesis, we are going to reject the null hypothesis. But if the sample is not very different from the null hypothesis, we will not reject the null hypothesis. But how different it is, how different between the two things, how different between the sample and the null hypothesis is determined, is illustrated by the probability. The probability under the null hypothesis that kind of sample may appear. when you're in a desert, you have a 90% chance to see a scorpion. Therefore, there's no large difference between the NOAA policies and this particular sample that somebody had seen a scorpion. And therefore, we cannot really say that this sample is very different from the NOAA policies. But on the other hand, only 5% of people who have been to a desert in Africa have seen a scorpion. That suggests that there's a large difference between this kind of sample and the stated NOAA policies. So that will lead us to possibly we are going to reject this NOAA policies. We probably believe that this person actually is in savanna environment, not in the desert environment. The next person report said, "I have seen a lion." Again, I want to see now what make a comparison between the sample that somebody have seen a lion, and this also compare that with the NOAA policies that I'm in a desert. I want to see between these two things how different that is. And I look at my record, I've seen that of all the people who have been to a North African desert, only 1% people have seen a lion. There's a small probability. So if you have been to a desert in North Africa, you would have only 1% probability seeing a lions. So that suggests that this between the fact that somebody seeing a lion and this no hypothesis, there's a large difference. You can really see that the big difference may lead us to reject the no hypothesis that he is in a desert. So you can see the general trend. At some point, the probability of seeing something in the desert become very small, and that would make that small probability would suggest that between the two things in comparison, the no hypothesis and the sample, between the two things is very, very different. Under that small probability, those kind of a sample will rarely occur in desert. Seeing hyena or seeing lion or seeing gorilla are very rare event for somebody who has been in a desert. With this kind of small probability, that really suggests a big difference between the null hypothesis and those evidence. And therefore, based on those evidence, we may have to reject the null hypothesis that they are in the desert. So with the probability become smaller and smaller, that would indicate the difference between the null hypothesis and the evidence become really large. And that kind of large difference between what happened in the sample and also what is suggested by the null hypothesis appear to be very different. And therefore, that give you a strong reason to reject the null hypothesis. So when the probability become very small, those kind of evidence become very, very unlikely, very rare under those null hypothesis. And that gave us a reason to believe that this student, she or he, is not in the desert. Okay. However, if for the fact that somebody report that they saw scorpion, they saw snake, they saw a lizard, these variations, those events may occur at different probabilities. You saw snake, I saw scorpion, somebody else sees lizard. They just by chance they saw different animals. But basically all those conditions occur at relatively high probability for the given null hypothesis. So we have no reason to reject the null hypothesis when those evidence occur. When somebody sees scorpion, somebody sees lizard, somebody sees snake. So just by chance you saw different animals, but whatever animal you see, as long as they have a high probability to occur under the null condition, Therefore, we have no reason to reject the null hypothesis. Okay. Just by chance, you may see different things. But as long as those different animals all occur under the high probability for the given null hypothesis, they are not regarded as rare. They are not regarded as unlikely. So this example illustrates that the difference between the null hypothesis and the sample is illustrated by a probability. The lower the probability under the null hypothesis, as more unlikely those kind of events are going to occur, and more likely we should reject the null hypothesis. Okay, so this is another way to understand the logic of hypothesizing.